Everyone, thank you for coming out. I'm Kyle Cleveland with the Institute of Contemporary Asian Studies. This evening we have Pallavi Aiyar, who is an award-winning foreign correspondent and author. She's reported from across China, Europe, Indonesia, and Japan. She is the author of the 2008 China memoir, Smoke and Mirrors, which won the Vodafone Crossword Popular Award. Her 2011 novel, Chinese Whiskers, was published in the United States, Europe, and India. She is also the lead author of The Lonely Planet Guide to China. Her Punjabi Parmesan, Dispatches from a Europe in Crisis, is a unique Indian-Chinese take on contemporary European crises. Her latest book, which is the subject of this evening's lecture, is Choked, Living Inside the World's Most Polluted Cities, which is an in-depth look at air pollution in New Delhi and Beijing. In 2010, she was recognized by the Chinese Premier, Wen Jiabao, for her work in furthering Sino-Indian relations. And in 2014, she was selected by the World Economic Forum as a young global leader. She is also a Brains Trust member of the IMD-based think tank, the Evian Institute. She has first-class degrees from Delhi University, Oxford University, the London School of Economics, and the University of Southern California. She lives in Tokyo. You can find her website. I think this will be a very interesting lecture tonight. I've been looking forward to this. A lot of my students are here. Thank you for coming out. And she will speak for about 40 minutes, and then we will have an open Q&A. You should note, by the way, that we are videotaping this, and we're going to ask you to come up to this mic. But for now, let's welcome Pallavi.
Thank you. Thank you very much to everyone for coming out here this evening. And thanks in particular to Temple University, Kyle and Eriko for organizing this talk today. We're going to be talking about air pollution. And pollution and I have somewhat of a kind of long and intimate history. This is not because I enjoy breathing poisoned air, but because by some twist of fate, I happen to have been born in developing Asia rather than in the post-industrial rich West. So except for a few years of my life, I have lived most of my 41 years in the crowded, chaotic megalopolises of Delhi, of Beijing, and of Jakarta, Indonesia. So the fumes of vehicles, factory chimneys, smokestacks, burning trash and leaves, these have really been the sort of dominant smell of my personal biography. And I have to say that what is common to all the polluted Asian countries that I've lived in is the matter of factness of the dirty air. Until fairly recently, toxic skies in these nations were just seen as an immutable, unmodifiable fact of life, either explained away as episodes of bad weather, or simply accepted as one amongst a sea of challenges. In contrast, rich country visitors to these cities and expats perceive the pollution as a kind of horrific public health emergency. It is, of course, both. It is a crisis, and it is also a fact of life. But the emergence of a growing, health-conscious middle class in many of these countries, greater international exposure, combined with truly appalling levels of pollution, have begun to lead to an awakening, or an air-awakening, across the region. So people often ask me, how different is Beijing to Delhi? How different is China to India when it comes to this issue of ambient air pollution? And I have to say that when it comes to popular perceptions, what the average person on the street really thinks of pollution, it wasn't so much different as very similar. I kind of see a trajectory to the story of pollution in these cities, beginning with a denial, the fact that the pollution doesn't really exist, that it is just fog, it is just smog, it is just a dust storm. Going on to a kind of indifference, a kind of acceptance of the fact that, yes, the skies are dirty, but what can we do about it? This is just a fact of life. And finally, reaching a kind of inflection point where there is a popular demand, an upsurge asking for change, and resulting in some degree of action. And although this action might remain incomplete, contested, there is some action. I first moved to China, to the city of Beijing, in 2001, and I lived there for 7 years until 2009. And it's interesting because when I look back on those years, the first half of that period, up till around 2006, I don't really remember pollution as figuring on the reporting scape particularly. I was there as a journalist, and almost all the stories we wrote in those days used to be focused on the so-called China miracle, on this amazing feat that the country had pulled off in propelling itself from a formerly poor agrarian society into the manufacturing center of the world, into its staggering economic achievements and its jaw-dropping infrastructure. My reactions at that time to the kind of mutterings of rich country expats about the dirty air, and there were a few, they were kind of akin in many ways to that of most Chinese themselves. I dismissed them as overblown first world concerns. You know, in countries like India and China, we were habituated, used to an entirely different level of risk. We had dirt, we had phlegm, we had the viruses of the developing world. Our perception of risk was so different and so numerous that risks really presented as immutable facts of life rather than circumstantial perils against which we could actually protect ourselves. I date my sort of real awareness of how bad the pollution was in Beijing to a spring morning in 2006, which was like any other morning in most respects. I woke up, I had a cup of coffee, I had a breakfast, and I went to my study. My desk was placed in front of a square-shaped window, and every day I would look out of this window, and I would see the sort of gray slate sloping roofs of the courtyard houses that comprised the neighborhood I lived in central Beijing. And in the distance, I would see some bulldozers and some cranes. This was in the run-up to the Olympic Games. The entire city was being essentially razed to the ground and rebuilt. This was the backdrop to which I had lived for the last 11 or 12 months that I'd been living in that particular apartment. But on this day, I looked out of the window, and what did I see? I saw a mountain. And it was just magical because I had been looking out of the same window day after day for 12 months, and suddenly there are hills where there had been none before. And I realized, of course, that this had nothing to do with magic and everything to do with the absence of air pollution on that particular day. And that really drove home to me exactly how filthy what I was living with on an everyday basis was. What really brought a change about in China, and in Beijing in particular, was the Olympic Games that the city of Beijing played host to in 2008. On the one hand, the city went into this kind of construction overdrive to create Olympic-worthy infrastructure, plunging the capital into a years-long haze of construction dust. And on the other hand, the hosting of a prestigious event, international event like the Games, helped to amplify the city's shortcomings. After years of having gawped at the economic successes of China, the Games in many ways provided the perfect opportunity for the international media to hold the Chinese authorities to account for their many failings. These failings were numerous and included media censorship, corruption, human rights abuses, stinky public toilets, but more than any other issue, I think pollution really bestrode the coverage of the Olympic Games like this kind of colossus. And not surprising, perhaps, considering that it was a sporting event after all, which makes the respiratory system and lungs something of a concern. But in many ways, this was the time when Beijing's air quality kind of emerged as the ultimate test for the Chinese Communist Party's willingness to seriously modify their policy of sacrificing everything to the god of GDP growth. As 2008 approached, there was so much construction activity in Beijing that municipal authorities were updating city maps every 3 months. We had new maps coming out every 3 months. And by some estimates, half of the world's production of concrete and one third of the world's production of cement was being consumed by China in those days and its voracious appetite for construction. So in the run-up to the games, the city of Beijing was really the seething collection of building sites, chemical factories, cement manufacturers, coal-fired power plants, and millions of polluting vehicles. In those days, the city was adding 1,000 new cars to its roads every single day, bringing total car ownership up to 3 million in 2006, a number which was then to increase to around 5 million by early 2012. A few years into my stint in Beijing, I remember developing this kind of constant throat irritation. And when I would leave the city, it would clear up. When I returned, it would return. And there was, you know, a lot of gallows humor in those days. I remember I had a Swedish friend who used to joke that a year in Beijing was equivalent to a dog year because it aged you by 7 years every year that you lived over there. So Beijing has really emerged as the kind of poster boy for air pollution in the international imagination. You say pollution and people think of Beijing. But my book demonstrates that firstly, China might actually have rounded the corner, that in fact, contrary to popular perception, China's air pollution is gradually getting better, not worse, and that really it's New Delhi, the capital of India rather than Beijing, that is the place we need to be worrying about. In 2014, a World Health Organization study ranked Delhi as the world's most polluted city. Neither Beijing nor any other Chinese city even figured in the top 20, but 13 Indian cities did. These were Patna, Gwalior, Raipur, Ahmedabad, Lucknow, Kanpur, Firozabad, Amritsar, Ludhiana, Allahabad, Agra, Khanna, and Delhi. Together, they make up this huge area that spreads across northern India, what we call the Indo-Gangetic Plains, just 2,400 kilometers in length. The WHO report that fingered Delhi as the world's most toxic city revealed that the Indian capital's average PM2.5 concentration was at 153 micrograms per cubic meter. While in Beijing, the corresponding number was only 56. So we're talking about 56, this is a yearly average, versus 153. Overall, Delhi's PM2.5 levels were close to 3 times Beijing's average and 15 times the World Health Organization guidelines, which is around 25. I was recently in Delhi, 3 weeks ago, and we had some days where it was ranging in the 400 and 500 level. And every year during the festival of Diwali, which is a big national holiday in India, and we burst a lot of firecrackers, and it also coincides with agricultural clearing in neighboring areas and so on, there are days when areas of Delhi have PM2.5 levels at 1,000. I've heard it can go up to 2,000. These are levels at which instruments can't even measure it anymore. According to NASA satellite data, PM2.5 levels across India actually got worse by 13% between 2010 and 2015. China's steadily improved during this time. Last year was the worst on record in India in terms of particulate pollution and the best in China. Beijing actually saw a 16% annual fall in PM2.5 levels, according to analysis that was done by the Paulson Institute and Greenpeace. NASA information shows that PM2.5 levels across China fell by 17% between 2010 and 2015, same time as in Delhi, they actually rose by 16%. So we're seeing quite dramatic improvements, particularly coming in 2014, 2015. I think this has to do with the fact that there are new regulations that just went into place in 2014 on nitrogen oxide pollution abatement equipment on power plants, which we'll talk about soon. Now, a lot of people who actually live in China, who actually live in Beijing, they find this data very difficult to accept because in many ways it seems to belie and contradict their lived experience. They're living there and they still find the air terrible. You have days when you can't breathe, you have days when you can't see. You have red alert days when they have to actually shut down factories, close schools and so on because the air is so dangerous that they are advising people not to leave their homes. Their response is shaped by the fact that in the winter in particular, you end up having some extremely horrific episodes every year. This has to do with a weather phenomenon called inversion, where you have cold air that rises, warm air that rises and traps the cold air close to the ground, and the pollutants are therefore kept close to the ground. It's like a pressure cooker and everything is stuck. And it also has to do with the geography of Beijing, which has hills on three sides, so it's difficult for the air to actually escape. So on average, the air might have improved and is improving, but it can still feel really bad for certain episodes. And it is these episodes that really sort of seem to stay in people's minds. So it's quite clear from China's battle that very long time horizons are involved in cleaning up the air. You know, the world has got used to the Chinese Communist Party sort of pushing through change at Shinkansen speeds. But there is no shortcut to fighting air pollution, and the effects of regulations take years and even decades to realize. And in the meantime, there will be spells when the air can feel as bad, if not worse, than ever. Before talking more about pollution, I think it's also important to unpack what exactly air pollution is. What is ambient air pollution and why does it matter? It's actually a confounding mix of things. It's a complex mix of particulates on the one hand and gases on the other. The abbreviation PM, you heard me talking about PM 2.5 earlier. PM is particulate matter, and it tends to be designated as either 10 or 2.5. 10 and 2.5 refer to the size of the particles themselves, to their diameter. Dust particles from wind-blown soil and construction activity tend to be between 2.5 and 10 micrometers in diameter, and these are called PM10. To put this in context, though, in terms of how tiny they are, a single strand of human hair is usually between 50 and 70 micrometers in diameter. So we're talking about between 2.5 and 10 for PM10, which is coarse. Fine particulate matter, PM 2.5, is less than 2.5 micrometers in diameter and only visible through an electron microscope. Produced by the combustion of motor vehicles, by combustion in power plants, the burning of biomass. By biomass, I mean leaves and twigs, dung cakes, and so on. These particles are minuscule enough to be absorbed very deep into the lungs. It is so fine that it bypasses the natural defenses of the body in the nose and in the airways, and it can settle deep into the alveoli of the lungs. This is where oxygen and carbon dioxide are exchanged. So the presence of PM 2.5 in the lungs at this level can cause potential damage to these vital organs, and it can also pass the blood-brain barrier and actually go into the brain. They're that small. Of all the components of air pollution, the health effects of PM 2.5 are the best researched, and unfortunately the news is terrible. They're linked to illnesses, to hospitalization, premature death, respiratory disorders, of course, like bronchitis, asthma, inflammation of the lungs, persistent coughing, and so on, but also life-threatening heart attacks, strokes. And in 2013, we had the World Health Organization concluding that PM 2.5 is also linked to lung cancer. The other main component of ambient air pollution are poisonous gases of various kinds. These are collections of molecules that are tinier than the smallest particulates. These are only 2 to 3 atoms wide. They include sulfur dioxide, SO2, what we call NOx or nitrogen oxides of various types, and ozone. And it's also important to point out that sulfur dioxide and NOx can actually produce PM 2.5 as well. So they're not completely separate from PM 2.5 under the right atmospheric conditions. Sulfur dioxide is caused mostly by coal and oil-fired power plants, steel mills, refineries, pulp mills, smelters, anything that operates burning fuel like coal, oil, and diesel, all of which contain large quantities of sulfur. and they are all ruinous for the respiratory system, causing inflammation of the lining of the lungs, reducing the body's immunity to lung infections, and can aggravate existing heart conditions, leading to hospitalization and, on occasion, death. The same holds true for nitrogen oxides. And ozone is something that I found quite interesting when I was researching the book, because, you know, from dimly remembered high school textbooks, I always thought that ozone was a good thing. We needed more of it. But this is ozone in the atmosphere, at the atmospheric levels, which helps to protect from UV rays. What is very harmful is ground level ozone, ozone that is found at the ground level. And this is a major component of what we call smog. In high concentrations, it can be a major health hazard. What is the situation currently, given the levels of air pollution that we have in Delhi? We have 627,000 premature deaths a year that are attributed to ambient or outdoor PM2.5 exposure alone. When you add to this figure household pollution or indoor air pollution that is caused from cooking stoves and so on, this number rises to well over 1.6 million. There are numerous city-specific and national studies that establish associations between pollution and respiratory infections in infants, low birth weight, chronic lung illnesses, and cancers in adults. We had one important study that showed PM2.5 was linked to up to 16,200 premature deaths in the city of Delhi alone, and a staggering 6 million cases of asthma. We have another research study that was done last year showing that 4 out of every 10 children in the Indian capital suffers from serious lung problems. It's very important to distinguish between household and ambient air pollution, and these two kind of tend to get lumped together very often. In many ways, household air pollution tends by comparison to be neglected over ambient air pollution. However, I would argue that it's a much worse public health emergency. It is associated with a larger number of deaths as well, but it mainly affects the poor, it mainly affects women, and it tends not to get the same kind of coverage. Ambient air pollution is the air that the rich breathe as well. It's the air that everybody breathes outside. But household air pollution results from the incomplete burning of biomass cakes. So basically, people who use wood and who use cow dung and so on as cooking fuel. In India, 700 million people are still exposed to smoke from these kinds of stoves, what we call chulas. And in addition to PM2.5, carbon monoxide, sulfur dioxides, and NOxes, they also produce hundreds of other pollutants, including formaldehyde, benzene, dioxins, and so on. Known effects are tuberculosis, blindness, miscarriages. We have a researcher from the University of California at Berkeley who estimates that smoke from an open cooking fire is the equivalent of smoking 400 cigarettes per hour. Now, some of these comparisons, you know, the science behind them is dubious, and it is certainly debated in any case. But needless to say, it is very, very, very toxic. And from a public health policy perspective, indoor household pollution should be as much of a priority as tackling ambient air, indeed more so. Unlike expats, tourists, and the middle classes, the poor can't afford to take mitigating action. And it's also in the interests of the rich, simply because a substantial percentage of the ambient 2.5 concentrations in the air outside actually escaped air that are coming from households, slum clusters within urban cities that are using these kind of cooking stoves, up to 30%, according to some studies. This is the kind of traditional cooking stoves that are used by 700 million Indians still. Again, you know, like I said, people often ask me, what is the big difference between India and China when it comes to air pollution? I talked earlier about the similarities in sort of popular perceptions and reactions to it. But I think one very big difference was not in government attitudes or people's attitudes or censorship or obstruction, but simply in the availability of data. There is very little data available in India. Until last year, we didn't even have any serious source apportionment study that was conducted in the city of Delhi. Source apportionment meaning where is this pollution coming from? If you have very polluted skies, what can you attribute this pollution to? So you had a bunch of policies, but they were all being taken essentially in the blind. You had people saying, it's the cars, so let's limit the cars. You had people saying, it's the agricultural burning in neighboring states, let's make that illegal. You had people saying, it's poor people who burn trash in the winter, so let's make that illegal. But essentially, there was very little data that was available to back up any of these measures. What we do have, and we still don't have comprehensive data, although one major study from the Indian Institute of Technology, Kanpur, came out last year. That's supposed to be the first really authoritative one, and I'll go into it. Obviously, it is some kind of combination of vehicles, industry, power plants, as well as combustion of coal and biomass in households. What we are trying to find out is what proportion can be attributed to what source. So this IIT Kanpur study found that 56% of PM10 originates in what they call road dust. 10% only in industrial points, 10% in concrete batching plants, and only 9% from vehicles. In the case of PM2.5, they came up with 38% attributable to road dust, 20% to vehicles, 12% from domestic fuel, and 11% from industry. Well, I think one thing that's important to keep in mind, because I was like, what exactly is road dust? I mean, since road dust seems to be the dominant source for both PM2.5 and PM10, I sort of take exception with the idea of road dust being seen as a completely independent and different source of pollution. To begin with, road dust and vehicular pollution are very closely related. The friction of tires moving on unpaved dirt roads and dust-covered paved roads creates this dust. Road dust also consists of deposits of vehicle and industrial exhaust, particles from tire and brake wear, gases released from wood and waste burning along the sides of the roads, as well as dust from construction sites. So it can't really be considered a wholly separate source from vehicular, industrial, or biomass burning pollution. But in any case, it gives you a snapshot of what the main sources are. You know, when I talk to people about air pollution in cities like Beijing, in cities like Delhi, often there is this huge sense of despair. What can we do about it? It's just too huge to deal with. And I have to say, what I say to them is that pollution is really not something that's beyond human capacity to do anything about. It's a human-made problem with human-made solutions. We all have a tendency to historic amnesia. There is nothing that special about what China and India are going through. In all the relatively clean nations of the rich West, there were horrific episodes that lasted decades and centuries often related to terrible air pollution. Until the 1950s, a permanent haze enveloped cities like London, Leeds, and Manchester. The lack of exposure to sunlight meant that rickets, which is a disease that affects healthy bone development in children, was something that was endemic in the United Kingdom. Coal smoke was linked to between 800,000 and 1.4 million deaths from respiratory disorders in the UK between 1840 and 1900. And in 1952, in London, there was the Great Smog, which lasted for a week and is thought to have killed up to 4,000 people prematurely. The United States has similar horror stories. I think the most common one that's brought up is of the city of a small industrial town called Donora, which was in Pennsylvania. And this was engulfed by such a putrid fog in 1948, in the October of 1948, that 20 people ended up dying and 7,000 were hospitalized with respiratory problems. And this was because the town had a zinc smelting plant, and it was a similar situation of temperature inversion that day, where the pollutants basically got trapped close to the ground and did not lift for several days. So toxic air is really a side effect of industrialization, the sort of fundamental economic transformation by which agrarian and largely poor societies have become rich and industrialized. Pollution, in other words, has long been the collateral damage of development. And the countries of the West, as in much of the developing world today, the urge to get rich outweighed the urge to breathe clean air. And it took these nations decades to gain the necessary level of economic development, public awareness, legislation, and crucially, the ability of implementation of these policies, so the capacity of governance in many ways, before their citizens could enjoy what is the most valuable luxury of all, a clean environment. So the burning question, no pun intended, is whether a nation must become rich first before it can clean up its environment. And if so, whether it can become rich without polluting. The nations of the West don't actually provide us with examples that the developing countries of Asia can follow without polluting copious and hugely damaging amounts. On the other hand, research on the effects of pollution is both more advanced today and more widely disseminated than it was historically. Technologies, including pollution abatement equipment, renewable energy, and better grade fuel exist that did not exist half a century ago. Moreover, even developing nations today have substantial constituencies of urban middle classes for whom making a daily wage is no longer the driving force of life, which allows health to become a motivating concern. I actually believe that China is an example many Asian countries can learn from. Most of the experts who really know what's going on that I spoke to believe that China has rounded a corner when it comes to air pollution, and we are going to start seeing serious, visible improvements in the next 5 years or so. Why? To begin with, China's old sort of energy-intensive mode of development that relied on heavy industry and manufacturing and infrastructure projects has already begun to give way to a more services-oriented economy. I think in 2015, services made up something like 50.5% of the economy compared to 40% in the years that I lived in Beijing. As the country also continues to urbanize and grow, the new buildings that are being built are much more energy efficient than older structures, and buildings make up about 40% of China's total energy use. Although extensive coal use is still a problem, coal use in the total energy mix is down by a few percentage points. And more importantly, China's coal-fired power plants are increasingly efficient. The country has emerged as a leading producer of pollution abatement equipment. Regulations aimed at curbing nitrogen oxides went into force in 2014. Sulfur dioxide abatement equipment is also being upgraded so that plants will be able to remove about 97% of sulfur dioxide from air emissions, up from the current 90%. And all of this is being done using domestically produced equipment. China today is a world leader in the use and production of wind and solar photovoltaic energy. It produces almost as much energy from wind, sun, and water as all of France's and Germany's power plants combined. Also, performance evaluations for local officials have begun to factor in environmental measures. It used to only be GDP, and now we actually have environmental measures that are also being implemented as criteria according to which provincial bureaucrats will be promoted or not. Vehicular pollution is being addressed. By 2017, all vehicles nationwide will have to meet China's fifth set of standards, which is equivalent to Euro 5 standards. In cities like Beijing, where around 30% of the ambient air pollution is sourced to cars, hundreds of thousands of cars and trucks that don't meet the new standards have been taken off the roads. Restrictions have been placed on car ownership. Beijingers today can only buy one car. They are not allowed to buy a new car if they already have a vehicle registered under their names. In 2014, Beijing cut the number of new license plates by 37%. Over 2012. So the city really plans to limit vehicle growth to 6 million by 2017. Do remember that it went up between 2006 and 2011 from 3 million to 5 million. At the moment, it's just over 5 million. So they really have capped car growth. They have a lottery system where if you want to buy a car, you actually have to join a lottery to be able to get a number plate. And it limits it to something like 20,000. A month. Greenpeace points out that China has also developed one of the most extensive networks of air quality monitoring stations. There are 1,500 of these across the country in 900 cities. There is no other country in the developing world with this level of monitoring infrastructure. The comparison with India is revealing. For China's 1,500 air quality monitoring stations, India has 39 stations covering 23 cities versus 900 cities. And another very important thing that China did was set up regional air quality regulations, which set up structures for ensuring air quality across multiple provincial and urban jurisdictions. It's very important because air doesn't only circulate within city boundaries. It circulates across city boundaries in regions, in air sheds. The share of thermal power plants with basic pollution abatement equipment in China today is 95%. 95% of all power plants in China have basic pollution abatement equipment. The number for India, any guesses? What percentage of power plants in India have basic pollution abatement equipment? 10%. Yeah. So as I said, sort of repeating what I said. So what do we do? Air pollution has to be tackled at two levels. There's the individual bottom-up level, and then there's the top-down policy level. At the policy level, there's a lot that India can do in terms of taking a few pages out of Beijing's book. Beijing has struggled with this for the last 15 years. It's important to set deadlines for meeting national air quality standards, five-year targets, regional action plans that actually cover entire air sheds and address all major sources of pollution rather than one or the other on a piecemeal basis. I think this is something that's very important. Delhi so far has essentially reacted by doing an odd-even scheme where we've focused on cars as the main culprit and had a scheme in which the number plates, odd number plates and even number plates are allowed on alternate days as a way of reducing the number of cars on the streets during periods of emergency during the year. But this only addresses something that's visible. What doesn't get addressed is power, industrial sources and power plants, often because in India in particular, these are not located in the city, they are located in the surrounding regions. And once again, we are not treating this as an air shed problem, but as a city-specific problem, which is self-defeating. We need more empowered and better staffed pollution control boards. India's central pollution control board has 550 employees. In the US, the EPA has 18,000 employees. In China, just the city of Yantai. Has anybody heard of the city of Yantai? Small city by Chinese standards. In China, Shandong province. Just that city, just the EPA over there has 4,000 staff. Need to develop more local level environment institutions to regulate and implement anti-pollution policies. India currently only has pollution control boards at the national and state levels. China has EPBs at the national level, the provincial level, the prefectural level, the city level, the county and district levels, and in some cases at multi-provincial levels. Thermal power plant emission standards are a must. We need to expand the scope and the quality of public transport. And I think it's also very important to make the general power grid a lot more reliable. One of the big problems in cities like Delhi, and indeed all Indian cities, is that we have massive power cuts through the year. And when that happens, offices and homes tend to use diesel-generating generators as backups. And this is a major cause and a major part also of the ambient air pollution. So some parting thoughts. I think when we are looking at air pollution in countries like India, we're seeing new kinds of inequalities emerging in the short term. Why is that? Air pollution in many ways is very democratic. It cuts across caste lines, it cuts across class lines, and so on. However, You do have what ends up happening is those who are well informed, who have access to information, and who have the means to do so, essentially buy themselves mitigating equipment. So you have this huge flux of people buying N99 masks, buying air purifiers. You end up having this whole, you know, sort of sub economy that comes up about discussing what is the best car purifier to have. You have examples in cities like Beijing where international schools have built sports fields under domes. I mean, you actually have big bubbles, and the children go and play under these bubbles. But you know, the majority of people who can't afford any of this breathe the air. So you end up having these kinds of new inequalities appearing. I also think that it's important to sort of take away the time span that's involved in the cleanup of dirty air. It is unfortunately not a short-term affair, which makes it very difficult for governments, because governments work in their five-year election cycles and people want to see immediate results. But air pollution, and we can see this from China's experience, which has been tackling air pollution quite consistently for the last 15 years and continues to be really, really badly polluted today, is a 15, 20-year process. There's really no silver bullet. Blue skies, they entail a tough slog. They require political will. They require citizen awareness. They require a certain amount of civil society activism, commercial compliance, and bureaucratic incentives. It's a tough ask under any circumstances, but I think that for countries like India, given the sort of fractured polities, large populations of desperately poor citizens, bureaucratic impunity, and rampant corruption, it's an even tougher ask. And finally, I'll just leave you with some more gallows humor. This is another kind of one of the jokes doing the round in China very often, where you have a reporter asking a senior citizen, "Grandma, has the smog been affecting you very badly and bringing you inconveniences?" And she replies, "Too much inconvenience. If you could see, you'd know I'm a grandpa, actually." So thank you very much. It was a pleasure to talk with you, and I'd love to take some questions.
So everyone, if you would like to ask a question, you need to come up to this mic. And note that we are filming this, so you're basically implicitly giving your permission to be filmed. We have a TUJ website, YouTube channel, and eventually it will go up on that channel. So don't be shy. Come up here. And you don't necessarily need to wait to be called on. You can just line up. So if you could please come up to the mic and ask questions.
I'll ask a question. My name is David Litt. I teach at KO down the block. There was a lot of press about the U.S. embassy in Beijing announcing and becoming a source of trusted information, maybe not in the future, but at least up to now, trusted information that citizens of Beijing would look to every day. What has this done to, is there any interesting things going on in terms of access to information about, has it changed the way that the government has responded to citizens?
Yes, absolutely. Sorry, go on, complete your question.
And also, I know there's an organization here in Tokyo, Safecast, which has done citizen monitoring for radiation after Fukushima, and has gotten an international organization, and they're now planning to do the same thing for air pollution, so that people would have their own PM 2.5 monitors, I think, around the globe. So, I'll sit
down. Yeah, you know, the role of the US Embassy in Beijing's story of pollution was quite crucial. Because until around 2007, the Chinese didn't, although this data was available, firstly, there were questions about how accurate the data was, where exactly it was being collected from, because there were very few points in which it was being collected. And the data was presented in a way which did not distinguish the different elements of the pollution, so it also made it very hard for a layperson reading the data to actually understand what it meant. It was more confusing and obfuscating than illuminating. So the American embassy used to have their own little monitor up, which is right in central Beijing, and began to publish this and essentially send it through Twitter. And it became a widely popular source, particularly for the expat community. I don't think it was as popular for the domestic Chinese audience as it was for a way for a lot of foreign journalists who were writing about it to actually get the information. But following that, there was pressure that was put on the Chinese. And from around 2012, we now have data released by the government along similar lines, which breaks it down. And it also now adheres to the same standard. For many years, the Chinese national standard was actually different to the international standard or the standard that the US kind of held to be the international norm. So that has also changed. What I found very interesting was why the US embassy was not doing the same in Delhi, even though the air was as bad to me than it was in Beijing. So, you know, it was, I mean, everybody in Beijing was like monitoring hourly updates. I mean, literally, oh my God, did you see it? 700. I mean, the vocabulary of PM2.5 is rich in Beijing. And then you would go to Delhi and there was a blanket. I mean, nobody even talked about it. It was not an issue. People would talk about corruption. People would talk about the safety of women. I'm talking about the foreign community, even sanitation, but not pollution particularly. And it was very interesting to me because we had not the Olympic Games, but we had our own smaller version in 2010, the Commonwealth Games. And in the run-up to the Commonwealth Games, all kinds of articles were written about lack of cleanliness, lack of preparation for the athletes' village, dengue fever, malaria, etc. Nothing on pollution. I always found that interesting, the sort of comparison. And I think partly India was just let off the hook for a very long time. It was sort of seen as, you know, everything in China gets amplified because of the fact that it's an authoritarian system of government. So the interest in kind of skewering the government is higher from the international media than it is in India. So I definitely think there was a double standard over there. The US Embassy since 2013, if I'm not mistaken, has started releasing that information now. But it was much further down the line than it was in China. Yes.
Hi, my question is about the development without needing to pollute first. The West has had a very, very long process where then, you know, in the Middle Ages, they would have plenty of pollution, not even knowing what it was, and even up until the, you know, Industrial Revolution, it was many, many years, century, long before things really got better. But China has, I believe China has turned it around, if this is their rounding the corner, in much less time than the West has. Do you think that future countries that industrialize will, like, and maybe even in Africa, will start doing it more efficiently, more quickly, and without so much pollution?
Yeah, I would think so. I mean, the whole process of industrialization in the West was one that took place over the course of centuries. In China, it was kind of telescoped into a 30-year period, just the process of industrializing, which also means that the pollution itself escalated very quickly. However, as I mentioned earlier, firstly, the information is available today, which was not available, say, 150 years ago. And secondly, we do have technology available, like pollution abatement technologies, for example, that were not available to these countries 150 years ago. And you have substantial constituencies of sort of urban middle class, more globalized constituencies that are demanding that of their politicians as well. So given all of that, I do think that they don't have to suffer a 150 year long period. However, I don't think that it's possible not to suffer the pollution at all. I mean, we haven't come up with a way of industrializing it, which is pollution neutral. There are ways in which you can minimize the impact and shorten the impact, perhaps. But I don't think that the West so far has provided us with any examples, at least, of something that we can copy. China, I think, for developing countries, is in many ways the example to be looking at because it industrialized very quickly, it polluted very quickly and copiously, and now it's tackling it very quickly as well. So in many ways, it's kind of the history of pollution in the West telescoped into a sort of three-decade space.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Hi, I just wanted to thank you for the talk. It's been really illuminating. And I'm sort of one of those people who really needs to be able to solve things. And so I'm wondering what we can do as individual citizens to not only sort of support these situations abroad, but also just continue to protect our air in the West, even though, you know, as you said, industrializing countries are certainly more exposed to pollutants.
Absolutely. I think, the problem with pollution is that it is very confounding because it cannot just work at the policy level, and it very much requires individual behavior change, which is one of the hardest things to bring about, behavioral change. It requires a particular change in the ways in which we consume, in the ways in which we commute. So I think commuting is a big part, particularly in cities like Delhi, where essentially public transport is bad. It's not expansive enough, and it's not regular enough. The quality is not high enough. So essentially, people want to use their cars. We have ridiculous situations. I mean, where I live in, which is a kind of upper middle class neighborhood in Delhi, where every house, where there'll be a four person house with four cars. Almost like a car for each person. These are the same people who are always saying, oh, how terrible the pollution, and buying the air, the face masks and the air purifiers, but sending their car like three times up and down from school because they forgot the lunchbox or whatever. It just is not factored into your daily life that you yourself are also part of the problem, and you yourself are also part of the solution. I've spent quite a lot of time talking, for example, to residents' welfare associations in neighborhoods in Delhi, and they say, the construction materials, the cities are being built in these parts of the world right now, so there's a tremendous amount of construction. The construction is not being recycled, it's not being disposed of properly, it's just kind of kept there, dust is flying up in the air. Simple things like that, nobody really wants to spend time thinking about it. Composting, instead of burning the leaves, which is what people do, why don't you just compost it? Recycling and thinking in terms of waste, how do we dispose of waste? Some of the residents' welfare association people told me that, people don't want to think about waste. They think it's something dirty and, toilets and, whatever. They just don't even want to bring it up. It's not something that they think is, polite to be discussing. It's certainly not proper to be talking about how we, deal with our wastewater, for example. So it's a long slog, and in fact, that I think is really the real challenge, which is changing behavior at the individual level, in terms of the choices that we make, in terms of how we consume. All of us are guilty of it, keeping the heating on longer than is necessary. Many, many choices that we make in our everyday life, and I think it's because it's a bit like smoking. The consequences of pollution are sort of, they're diffused. Whose fault is it? It's not really my fault, so you don't take responsibility for it. Plus, it's going to happen decades later, so you don't see a sort of immediate knee-jerk, reaction like I poke you and you move. Because of that, it's very hard to actually cause that kind of behavioral change, which is a very important part of the puzzle.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm Lindsay Nelson. I teach at University of Tokyo, and I just wanted to ask about what you said at the very end of your talk about the fact that so many solutions to pollution are not politically viable because they involve a very long time, and most politics works in cycles of 4 and 5 years. And I was just wondering, are there any historical precedents or any examples of strategies that Beijing has used or that other cities have used that have been politically viable and that have gotten support both from citizens and politicians?
Absolutely. The UK, we talked about the Great Fog that happened in 1952. That served as the catalyst for the passing of the UK Clean Air Act in 1956, which then formed the basis for all subsequent environmental legislation. And the same has happened. Sorry, what happened? The same happened in the US, where you essentially had the EPA set up and all the environmental acts that were passed through the 1970s. So it was a process. It didn't happen overnight. But you had these horrific episodes of pollution that served as the sort of inflection point that I talked about, which create a kind of, citizen movement and then start creating the demand from the bottom up for change. And it's a process. It can be done, and it has been done.
So there seems to be like a reliance on following Beijing as a guideline for...
That's my argument. I don't think that is actually usually the case. Beijing is normally seen as the poster boy for what not to do.
Okay.
In the popular imagination, Beijing is pollution central. It's the worst that you can get to. So it's actually kind of counterintuitive what I'm arguing.
Well, it seems... to me, from your talk, it seemed like the right thing, but... I was a little bit scared of how the difference between Beijing's pollution being less, not as much of the household pollution that you were talking about, so the same strategy of solving their pollution problems can't really be used as much.
You're right.
What is being, I mean, maybe this goes back to Anna's question, but what can be done about the problems that are home-based and can't be as well solved by a bigger scale?
You're right. When we're talking about the Beijing and Delhi comparison, I'm mostly looking at what we call ambient air pollution, which tends to be sourced from vehicles and industrial sources, not household air pollution, which is often by policy experts as well seen as a completely different kettle of fish, as it were. Mm-hmm. The solution to that is essentially providing people with clean stoves and clean fuels. Yeah, so liquefied like LPG is the fuel of choice in countries like India. And policy measures for that include providing subsidies and for those kinds of gases, as well as certain kinds of scientific designs. There's a lot of entrepreneurs that are coming up with very low cost clean stoves, which you can then distribute widely in rural areas. However, I just think that it's not much of a priority in many ways. A lot of the people who are affected by it don't even realize that they are affected by it. When you are looking at people at that level of development, they have much more chances of getting, you know, run over on the roads tomorrow. They're exposed to floods. They're exposed to many very immediate sort of health problems, which they tend to focus on. So they're often not even aware that it's a problem. So it doesn't become an election issue. It doesn't really gather the kind of momentum that ambient air has, because as I said, ambient air affects the rich as well. It affects the middle classes, and it's when they sort of go out and start demanding change that then, you know, people actually start responding to it at the political level. So it's a shame. But in India, household air pollution has been a huge it's been a public health emergency for decades. It's not something that's new, but it hardly ever makes headlines. Whereas once the WHO starts talking about it being a very polluted city, that's the polluted air that every expat is going to breathe, that tourists are going to breathe, that everybody is going to breathe, then it sort of suddenly becomes a newsworthy issue. Right. So I think you're absolutely right in pointing that out, and that's why I brought it up as in my talk as well, as two sort of separate things, mm-hmm. one which often doesn't get as much emphasis or exposure, and actually does not have particularly difficult solutions.
Yeah, okay, thank you.
Hi. Hi, I'm a junior at TUJ. My name's Daniel. I wanted to know let me rephrase this. I feel that clean air is an international problem, but ultimately it is a domestic problem at the basic level. Using China using Beijing as an example is well and good. But I feel the political climate in China versus the political climate in India are different, and the policies that are being able to be enacted in Beijing wouldn't be able to go over so well in India. Going off of that, facing those challenges, are there any NGOs that are being able to supplement the Indian government's inadequacies in that aspect, or are the people just kind of on their own?
No, millions of NGOs. India is like NGO land. There's an NGO everywhere you look. You know, you can't sort of move without bumping into an NGO. So unfortunately, it is all NGOs at the moment. And NGOs, you know, tend to have a very specific remit. They're like single focus, they tend to be. So there are people who are doing marvelous work in, you know, renewable energy. There are people who are doing some work in, for example, replacing the traditional cooking stoves with clean cooking stoves. There's all kinds of wonderful work that is being done by NGOs, but this is piecemeal. I think the one thing we've learned from Beijing, which we've learned from all countries, is that pollution is a multi-pronged problem because the sources are multiple. If you tackle one source but you don't tackle the others, it's not going to have any effect. Secondly, it's a cross-boundary issue. If you just tackle it in the city of Delhi, but 13 of the world's most polluted cities are in the same airshed right by Delhi, the air is not going to respect the boundary of Delhi and stop over there. It comes right in. So we also have to tackle it across airsheds, which inevitably makes it into a political top-down affair. It can't just be done by NGOs.
Okay, thank you.
My name is Kurt Sieber. I'm a senior. My question to you is, well, actually two questions. First, what is India's policy to comply with the requirements of the December 2015 Paris Agreement? And connected with that, is India planning to reduce the use of coal, the burning of coal, which China is now starting to do?
Yes.
for these very reasons? And what is the development of non-polluting renewables in India? Thank you.
Yes, thank you for the question. So I think we want it to be around 20% of our energy mix by 2030, renewable sources. And India has committed to that and also to improving energy intensity. But the problem really is on the monitoring and verification, because they don't want international monitoring and verification. So essentially, they have agreed to national targets, to domestic targets, but these are not legally binding internationally. Mm. So that's the point at which there is controversy. Mm. The actual domestic targets themselves are compliant with all of the others. The problem is whether or not you can verify them internationally, and India has not agreed to that.
Okay, well, I have some good news for you. I'm just coming back from Hawaii, and the policy of the state of Hawaii is 2045, 100% renewables, and Hawaiian Electric has just announced that they can beat that target by 5 years, and it will be 2040. The smallest of the islands, Molokai, will have 100% renewables by 2020.
That's fantastic. Unfortunately, the population of India and China is a little bit more than Hawaii. But that is fantastic
news. Quite a
little
bit, yes. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for your talk. My name's Alison Beale from the University of Oxford. I was wondering if you could identify any specific drivers, and I mean political drivers, that caused the Chinese government to act and to take action, and whether these drivers can be seen occurring in Delhi or India today.
Yeah, you know, I mean, ultimately, it's about legitimacy. And this is always a difference between India and China, because in India, you basically get legitimacy through elections. You're elected, that makes you legitimate for the next 5 years. Whatever you do, you have the mandate. I mean, Donald Trump is legitimate right now as mm-hmm. well, right? Whereas in China, because you don't have the elections, often the legitimacy comes from actually delivering and keeping the important constituencies happy. Which can often make it a much more effective system of governance compared to the democratic system that we have in India, which tends to be very process rather than performance oriented. In China, we see more performance than process. There is no sort of democratic process. So it was a question of, I mean, you know, when you've got enough people that are taking this seriously, the sort of urban, well-educated constituency is a very important constituency for the Chinese authorities. And they were essentially co-opted by giving them a lot of economic opportunities. But when that sort of starts wearing thin, then it does become important to respond to other concerns. There was, of course, also the whole international hoo-ha in the lead-up to the Olympic Games, the fact that it concentrated a lot of the criticism and crystallized it. So I think, you know, it's a very different, there are these sort of different drivers because the way in which legitimacy is processed in China is very different to in India. Another one?
You mentioned that transportation has and commuting is a big issue in India. It seems like, I mean, for the ambient air, you have both point sources like power plants and factories, and you have, millions of automobiles. Los Angeles, I think, had this problem in the 1950s where you couldn't see your hand in front of your face. And, improvements in the quality of gasoline and catalytic converters and regulation. You didn't deal with the behavioral issue. People still drive, I think, just as much as they ever have in Los Angeles, but you still buy changing, you know, the cars that they're driving in and the gasoline that they're consuming, you got rid of a lot of the pollution.
So we've changed that as well. The quality of the fuel has improved considerably. The amount of sulfur dioxide in the fuel has reduced dramatically. So in fact, Delhi tends to meet targets on sulfur dioxide. Okay. It's the only pollutant that it tends to meet on, and that's got to do with the grade of fuel. But at the same time, you also have an extreme explosion of diesel vehicles, which pollute with nitrogen oxides a lot more. And it's a long way to go. I mean, Delhi is one city, but if you go to second tier and third tier cities, they're 15 years behind where Delhi is. India as a whole wants to leapfrog and go to the Euro 6 levels by 2020. Whether or not we're going to be able to do that, the jury is out. And we can produce those Euro 6 compliant cars, but they're all for export at the moment. We don't actually use them in the country. In itself, it's not enough because it has to be addressed across the board. We converted to compressed natural gas in 2000 for all public vehicles in the city of Delhi. And still, it is as polluted as it is. So actually, all the buses and taxis and tuk-tuks, they all run on CNG today. And there was a kind of immediate effect in around 2002, 2003, where the situation improved briefly, but then just the sheer volume of new vehicles that are coming on, the pace of the industrialization and so on, is so outmatches the improvements that were gained by that conversion that it's not enough.
Hi there. I actually like that someone brought up Hawaii because I'm actually from Hawaii.
And so from Hawaii, yes. Right, okay, yeah.
And actually, I want to tell you a little bit of a story. I'm actually from Vietnam as well. And in Vietnam, we're actually very much polluted and maybe on the same standards as Delhi.
And yes, I've been to Hanoi. It's quite...
it's quite...
polluted.
It's quite a thing, yes, yeah. I mean, just imagine a whole river is just filled with trash and
garbage,
trash.
Yeah.
And the thing about pollution is not a lot of people take into consideration that it's the mindset of the people. And even though you can tell them, yes, pollution is the actions of what you're doing, even though they won't take that into consideration. And it's not just because of the mindset, it's because of convenience of nowadays. So like, if you compare, I've been living in Hawaii since I was born, and then I've been going back and forth to Vietnam like every once in a year. And I just actually came from Vietnam before I came to Japan. And then you compare like the whole lifestyle, it's like, this air is like making me die. But when you come to Japan, it's like, it's like a filter. So like, I guess my question to you is, if you can take into consideration that it's the mindset of the people, and instead of having people rely on just the politics and the government, like, what would you say about human actions? Like, what about behaviors?
Well, I think it's civil society activism is very important. You actually need citizen movements. And they have happened in the past. And in fact, most of the cleanups that we've seen in other parts of the world, including Japan, have had a major element of that sort of citizen involvement as well. In India, in the last, say, 4 or 5 years, we've had a couple of very big citizen movements. In 2011, we had a figure called Anna Hazare, who led an anti-corruption movement that was huge. And we have had more recently safety of women sort of civil movements that have happened in these big cities as well. We have not seen anything on pollution happening. I firmly believe we need that. Unfortunately, there are so many problems, and some that are more immediate than others in countries like that, that it makes it hard. And I think the other problem is that it tends to be seen in countries like, in cities like Delhi, as a sort of seasonal problem. So every winter, when the smog becomes a lot more visible, this is because of the weather conditions and as well as the fact that you have agricultural burning and so on, smog becomes front page news. As soon as those kind of weather conditions subside and you no longer see the smog as clearly, people sort of forget about it until next year when, you know, the season starts again and everybody gets very concerned again. This is, of course, nonsense, because just because you can't see it doesn't mean it exists. Something, ozone levels, for example, peak when temperatures are high in the summer. They're completely invisible. So the air that you are breathing can be as toxic, if not worse, in the summer, but it's not as visible, so people tend to forget about it. But you're right. I mean, it's a huge challenge because it is something that that needs citizen involvement. Mm-hmm. And it cannot just be done at the political level. It requires both to work in conjunction, which makes it a tough ask, but not impossible.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is Sego Izumot. Thank you for a wonderful lecture as well as your personal experience on this important issue. So you highlighted Beijing and New Delhi, but I wonder what the magnitude of the problem in other populated area like Bangladesh, Indonesia, Mexico City, perhaps other cities. So yeah. Maybe it's time that WHO or some other international agencies just not blame China, but take it as a global problem or universal problem of industrialization. And the second question I have is what about the effect of air pollution in the water quality? I recall that years ago, acid rain, presumably caused by sulfur dioxide and others, caused a lot of forest damage that allowed it, or that they attracted a lot of attention. And what is the effect on the air, the water quality in China and India?
Yeah, you make a very valid point, and I think the WHO itself admits it, that it only compiles data on where it's available. And one of the biggest problems is that most places just don't have the data. So some of the most polluted places in the world, we just have no idea. If you actually start every single city in the world, we'll get a completely different map to what the WHO has currently, including in India. Delhi is the capital. We have the most amount of information available about there. Second tier, third tier cities are far worse off than Delhi, but Delhi gets all the attention. It also has the data available. So the WHO rankings are by perforce a very, very partial picture of the world. And I think one of the main sort of policy movements that we need is to develop better monitoring networks in general, because until we have that information, we really can't take any sort of steps. It's the basic thing that you need to do. About water sources, water and air are of course very linked. The acid rain has been a huge problem. Something like 70% of China at one point had acid rain falling over it. 90% of groundwater is so polluted that it's absolutely undrinkable. Rivers are drying up all over the place. So the environment has to be treated as a whole. We've sort of taken air pollution as one particular example right now. It's one of the hardest to filter out. With water, the water is undrinkable in cities like Delhi. Delhi Belly, very famous. Yeah, everybody goes there. Almost everybody gets sick because it's full of bacteria and contaminants. Essentially, it's a sewage system problem where the sewage leaks into the drinking water supply. But all of this is interlinked. And the steps that I'm talking about, helping the environment at a policy and individual level, would help holistically. Whatever helps the air would help the water and so on. If you are changing the ways in which you commute, in the ways in which you consume, in the ways in which you recycle, that has an impact across the board.
Perhaps it just came to my mind that one thing NGO can do, the fact that a vast majority of the cities is not never measured, if someone can come up with a smartphone-based monitoring system, then
so they already exist, yeah, but then you have to have smartphones. A lot of these places are so poor that they wouldn't have smartphones available to the majority of population, but you have a lot of crowdsourcing going on, particularly in cities like Delhi and Beijing these days, where everybody has their own little individual monitors. They are called laser eggs, and you can tell what the quality of, you can measure the air at any given point, and then you upload your information into a kind of database so that people then share and communicate with each other of where is very polluted right now, where not to go at this particular point of time, should we let the children out to play or not. People are literally making day-to-day decisions based on this kind of information that is being shared by citizens wandering around with their little laser eggs. So it started, it is already happening.
Okay. Thank you.
Hi, so I was wondering about the population of China and India. They're the two most populous countries in the world, and how much of an issue that is. And with India in particular, the population in India is still very much growing. And so how would you get people to agree at an individual level to start thinking about these issues when, like, with the social inequality and the lack of education.
No, I mean, absolutely. That is obviously the fundamental challenge. Population is an issue. Like you rightly pointed out, it's more of an issue in India because China has actually slowed down to the point where it's experiencing negative growth in some areas. And they're actually planning to scrap the one-child policy in many areas because there's such a lack of people. In India, population rates have shrunk dramatically compared to, say, 30 or 40 years ago, but they still remain very robust, well above the replacement rate. And there was a time when India was supposed to overtake China, according to predictions, in terms of population size by 2030. I believe this is now going to be 2025. Some people say it's already happened, that we just don't have enough census data. But, I mean, it's a huge problem. However, once again, we end up with political constraints. When you have democracy, there are limits to the kinds of population measures that you can place. We have ways of encouraging people to have less kids. We have public service announcements and education drives and so on that encourage people to have two kids. Also, recently, the whole discourse has changed from sort of seeing population as a problem and, you know, as the source of a kind of Malthusian disaster to a demographic dividend. And the fact that the more people you have, if they're young, it's actually good because that means that the economy will grow and there's more people out there to work. So the whole discourse seems to have shifted a little bit. I am personally skeptical about that. I actually do think population is a huge problem and we should have more of a focus on it, which seems to have kind of become unfashionable. Compared to the time when I was growing up in the 1970s and 80s, we had a lot of public service announcements and the whole focus of a lot of focus of government policy was on encouraging smaller families. That actually seems to have gone out of the window a little bit. And population does get, it's kind of the elephant in the room in many ways because it's a problem, but it's very sensitive and it's very hard to address it in a democratic framework.
Thank you.
Hello. My question is regarding industrial pollution. So everyone say that industry is creating a lot of pollution problem. Okay, but your data also shows that only 10% and 13%.
IIT, yeah, not my data, but
IIT Kanpur. They say that only 13 and 10%.
In Delhi.
In New Delhi. Or I can say that around 4,000 square kilometer of central Delhi region. That constitute around 10 to 12%. And if you see the industrial data, like 60% of the total industry in India is populated in those areas. So the government is taking efforts to redistribute those industries. That's why they are making roads. So I don't think that is the major reason right now. Most important question is how to control the road dust. Mm. Because when you construct more and more highways, you have to dig and you lose the soil. And both the sides of the roads kept loose. There, you cannot irrigate with them. You cannot put water. So another question is, what is the difference you have observed to control road dust between India, China, or Western countries?
Or Tokyo. So I'm living opposite a construction site right now. Yeah. And I'm amazed because every morning I don't notice the dust. I'm literally opposite the construction
site. Because they cover it up.
And I open it. And also they have hoses Spindle. That are tamping down the water constantly. So it doesn't sort of fly up. Yeah. And other than the noise, it really hasn't bothered me particularly. No, I mean, road dust is a huge thing, right? So when you are transporting materials, for example, from place A to place B for construction sites, just cover the trucks. They don't do that in India. It's all open. It's going out, it's flying out. I mean, these very, very basic, low-tech, not expensive kind of solutions are available. Unfortunately, instead of doing those, we sort of leapfrogging to very technological. It'll be like there's this idea of having these vacuum, these giant vacuum cleaners that are going around and sucking up the dust. I mean, that's fine for a short-term kind of measure. But in the long term, you just have to develop better practices for how you deal with construction materials at the site and also during transportation. It's not rocket science, but talking about the fact that industrial pollution is only 10%. You know, all of these studies are a little bit controversial, and there are studies that contradict the exact source apportionment. The other thing to keep in mind is that that's also because there's not a lot of industry in Delhi, unlike Beijing, which actually had a lot of heavy industry in the city. So it's possible that a lot of the Delhi pollution is coming more from cars. However, this the industrial policy should not be ignored because it's polluting wherever it is, in the second tier and the third tier cities. Plus, it's in the airshed of Delhi. So even if it's polluting, say, in eastern UP, eventually the air is also going to circulate through Delhi. So industrial policy and pollution tends to be a bit of a blind spot because Delhi gets all the attention and because Delhi doesn't actually have heavy industry within the city boundaries, which is why we have a situation where only 10% of power plants in India today have pollution abatement technology compared to 90%+ in China. So I actually think industrial pollution needs to be taken more seriously than it is. We concentrate too much on cars. I mean, everything is essentially focused on cars, which is, you know, certainly one part of the problem, but it's a multi-pronged challenge.
One thing I have observed, the difference between roads, is grasses. Like in all Western countries, even in Japan, you can see grasses are planted across the roads. So that can hold the soil.
Binding the soil, yeah.
That can bind the soil. And it prevents any air to take away the dust and spread on the roads. So this is, I think, the basic thing which we Indian or the government is not thinking of. They are making, earlier it was 9 kilometers a day highways, now it has gone to 33 kilometers a day highways. They are losing the soil more and more. They are removing everything, but they are not trying to bind the soils along with that.
Thank you.
Hello, my name is Shams, and my question was, I know organizations and government are doing a lot of work on this issue right now. But what is being done for the next generation? For instance, is there any policies that requires public schools to teach kids about pollution?
No, not yet. So pollution is not big in, I mean, I think it is in many parts of the world. Certainly my children who go to international schools, but these are very elite schools, you know, by the time that they are 4 years old, they come back with their reduce, recycle, what's the three R's? Reduce, recycle, and?
Reduce.
See. and so on. But I would say the average school in India, absolutely not. Forget about schools, even doctors. There's a huge public health emergency in cities like Delhi. Like I said, 4 out of 10 children have respiratory lung disorders. When you go to a doctor in Delhi to discuss lung problems, pollution does not figure in the conversation, which to me is staggering. They will give you steroids, they will give you this, they will give you that. It's seen as a sort of medical problem. But in patient-doctor settings, they've done studies for respiratory disorders. Air pollution is never mentioned. It's almost as though it doesn't exist. And I've had conversations with foreign friends who've like kind of aggressively brought this up with their doctor. And the doctors just poo-pooed it and said, what are you talking about? You live in a very green neighborhood, lots of trees over there, nothing to worry about, you know. So it's not seen as something that's brought up particularly in schools. It's not brought up. It's this very, very nascent awareness in India. And like I said, it also tends to be seasonal. So it's a kind of, we have this pollution season from October to December, and then for the rest of the year, it's not even really discussed in the media.
Understood. Thank you.
Are there any type of international sanctions in place against countries that pollute a lot?
No.
Thank you.
Although it is an international issue, as in the, because just as air doesn't sort of circulates in air sheds across state boundaries and countries, it can also go across international borders. China's smog has gone to Korea. I believe it's even come up to Japan. I lived in Indonesia earlier in the island of Sumatra. The haze, they have a massive haze every year when they are clearing away agricultural land for planting oil palms. And that haze tends to go to Singapore, Malaysia. causes a lot of international diplomatic issues. So it's a diplomatic problem, and it, you know, does cross international boundaries, but we don't have any sanctions yet, no.
So do you think it would be kind of like hypocritical to place sanctions? I mean, you were saying earlier, like, every developed Western country has been through a phase where they have been polluting.
A lot of it comes out of poverty. I mean, a lot of the pollution comes out, for example, from the household ambient pollution of people who don't have access to clean fuels, who are essentially cooking with whatever they can, who don't have access to modern heating and so are burning leaves to keep warm in the summer. So you can't really punish people from being poor like that, you know? Yeah.
Thank you.
My name is David. I'm also a student here at TUJ. Just going back to touching on India's ideology, as in not, you know, you mentioned earlier they didn't like to accept foreign monitoring. So I was wondering, thinking back, maybe this is a consequence of being a post-colonial power in effect. And then in addition to that, I also would like to ask your opinion on the person that we have in the White House right now destroying all these trade agreements, how that may decrease exposure that people in India that might not be rich enough to go and tour in other places might have to this information.
Well, India was not really part of the TPP, but your earlier question, yes, I do very much think it has to do with being a post-colonial power. It's about power structures, it's about who made the rules and then who is now bound by them. So those issues do become very important in all of these international negotiations and have found, say, China and India on the same side in many ways, despite the fact that China, for example, has been doing a lot, but they feel like we are doing a lot and we are doing more than is required. Whereas you have not done anything, has sort of polluted all the, and now you're sort of telling everybody else what you can or cannot do. So yes, I do think that the sort of power structures which are very much at play in these international negotiations. About Donald Trump, I am reserving comment right now. I don't think I'm qualified to go into it. But yeah, I don't think he sounds like he's great news for the environment in general. Yeah.
All right, thank you.
Forty years ago, when I came to Tokyo, Tokyo wasn't that clean city. I remember.
I wanted to hear about that because I believe up till the 70s, it was very polluted as well.
I clearly remember. I'm from Fukuoka, and as airplane is going down Haneda,
you cannot see.
I couldn't see. I held my breath in airplane. Obviously, it doesn't make sense, but it was that bad. So good news is Tokyo is very clean. So maybe that one part of the effort should be directed toward what has Japan or Los Angeles, for that matter, what has London has done, what has the also economic analysis, what was most impactful, what was most cost effective, that may give some hint that where to tackle.
Absolutely, experience sharing is really crucial, and like I've stressed, this has been done before.
Yeah.
It's not an impossible thing to achieve. So yes, I totally agree.
Yeah, this is not really a question. It's more an answer to the Tokyo question. My company was actually strongly involved in these activities. I will just give you two examples. One of them was that we introduced the catalyst for the car exhausts. Toyota was our biggest customer, Nissan, Mazda, and so on. That was technology introduced from France. We were kind of, honored to say that you could see Mount Fuji. At the time, this gentleman just said, you could see it about 20 days per year.
In the year.
And we managed to get it up to 70 days per year through the catalytic converters. The second example is, and you mentioned that sulfur oxide is a very strong pollutant. Japan in the 1970s, 1980s were importing 3 million tons of sulfur from the United States. We introduced to all the refineries in Japan what was called a sulfur recovery catalyst, and we produced these 3 million tons of sulfur here in Japan. So the whole thing actually paid for itself.
Fabulous.
And that was contributing very much to the better air, which my family, my children greatly appreciated. Thank you.
Fantastic. Mm-hmm. Thank you for sharing that. So I think if there's no more questions, we could, Kyle?
So there's some books for sale over here.
Yes, which is not the book, because this book is available only digitally. You have to go to www.juggernaut.in, and it's available only digitally. I do have other books on China and Europe available for sale over there if anybody is interested, previous books. But that also, some of them go into environmental issues.
And what's your website address?
It's just my name, pallaviaiyar.com.
Okay. Well, thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you.